Very tight with Brian Cashman. He's good buddy to go on to lunch later today. Sweeny Murti. Hi, Sween.
Hi, fellas. How you doing?
Well, why did it seem to me that Cashman just was annoyed by you, even before you asked the question? And the question before we get to the whole passing on thing was about the medical staff. He just seemed, it reminded me of Gase. Why was he, have you guys had a history now that we're not aware of, you and Cash?
No, I've been fine with him in the past, and I'm sure I'm fine going forward. And I didn't take anything yesterday as a personal nature. I did start with the question following up about the medical procedure, and he was not, really ready to divulge. He said, the thing about, we got into an argument about semantics, about passing on a player, and just thinking about it, and I have not talked to him about it since. I guess the idea was that just using the phrase passing on indicated some level of professional negligence, and that's not what I was insinuating at all. I actually many times reported on the individual cases that we were talking about and the reasons the Yankees chose not to go down those roads. And they're all valid reasons in their own individual cases, whether it's the luxury tax issue on Verlander, who had appeared to be on a downturn, whether it's the prospect cost for Cole, who was not the pitcher who hadn't lost in the last 5 months, and whether or not it was going 6 years on Corbin, which was, obviously something that, many people have discussed as well. All I was really doing was establishing that as a whole, these things have all happened. And I was just, the question I was finally getting to was that, has Hal expressed any regret? Because there are more pitchers like that available this year. And as many as you guys know, because I've talked to you about it before, anybody else who's listened, who follows on Twitter, I've never once insinuated that the Yankees lost because they didn't have enough pitching. I've told you that they lost in 2017 because they didn't hit well enough. They lost this year because they didn't hit well enough. So maybe it's just the phraseology, or maybe it was the idea that probably this was going to be a narrative that was going to get driven at some point, and yesterday was a good opportunity to drive his points home.
But you know what? Like, us individually, I agreed with Cashman passing on all three guys, and I don't have a problem with the wording you used. He did pass. Yes, they were into Corbin at a price. Once that price got too high, they passed. They were interested in Cole. They were willing to give up certain prospects. Once the prospect cost got too high, what did he do? He passed. So Cashman's wrong, but I agree on passing on all three guys. But here's the thing. He turned out, I turned out, a lot of us turned out to be wrong specifically about Verlander and Cole, in that they are better than what I think we thought they would be. Cole had a mid-4 ERA in the National League. I didn't think he'd come out and win Cy Youngs. And Verlander, like you said, Sween, looked like he was on the decline. So it's weird. I think he was right for passing, but he's wrong for getting all, freaked out by you using the word passing. He did pass.
And that's really all that I was saying yesterday is, and like you said, there are all very valid reasons for making the decisions at the time they were made. And, and they're all real, and you can go argue them if you want, but really, it's a question about in hindsight, because what I was really just trying to do, and some people I think understood this, was that with more elite pitching available this year at probably a pretty high price, is there anything in your past that indicates maybe we need to go the extra mile this time? It was not an indictment of any way on how they conducted business in the past.
Listening to Cashman with you yesterday, I really felt that you struck a nerve there. I thought that's exactly what happened. I thought that, he was very sensitive about the fact that, you phrased it the way you did. You got all these three pitchers that you had interest in, I shouldn't say interest, because they even never really had interest in Verlander, that you passed on. I thought that kind of struck a nerve with him a little bit, to be honest. I thought that's why he was the way he was.
Well, again, I felt like maybe just that phrase indicated some level of negligence, where that's probably what maybe what he would have taken offense to. But as I said, the individual reasons for making those decisions all have validity to them. But as you look forward now, you start to think, okay, he defended his process, and that's really what I was trying to him get where I was trying to get him to was, you know, the process you use to evaluate, are you still comfortable with it? Is Hal still comfortable with it? Because the pitchers that in question have helped get their team to the World Series. I guarantee you, if Tampa Bay wins Game 5 or Brewers win the wild card game, I'm not asking the question in that manner. But the fact is that there are pitchers that the Yankees had opportunities to get that are now in the World Series, several of them.
You know what also I think adds to it? And by the way, not that you care that much about this, but I think you saw that like 90% of Yankee fans in your mentions were pro Sweeny. They were like, yes, Sweeny.
I think that was, I appreciate their sentiment, but it was in no way an attack on anybody. I thought it was a pretty civil conversation, to be honest with you.
Yeah. I think getting Giancarlo a few months after passing on a player because of their contract also looks bad. I understand they didn't win or didn't advance because of their offense, but when you look at Giancarlo Stanton, even coming off an MVP year, I think most Yankee fans would say, hey, I'd rather have the big arm than another big right-handed slugger that strikes out a lot.
True, but remember, the Stanton deal only happened because of the financial concessions made to get it under a certain, to get the total payroll under. Of course it was, but it worked because it got them under. The Verlander contract would not have gotten them under without making other moves. They were able to shed Castro's contract and get the Marlins to take a portion of that salary, which helped fit it under. And let's be clear, the reason that the Yankees have been so sensitive about the luxury tax threshold is not that they can't afford the money. It's the idea that that money goes to other teams and it has helped Tampa Bay beat you. The Rays take that money and beat you with it. And the idea being that tax has acted as a cap. Right. And I know fans don't like that because they think the Yankees can afford it all. Sure they could. But here's the analogy that I've made many times. If McDonald's was told that after a certain number of dollars spent on advertising, half of that money would go directly to Burger King and Wendy's, I guarantee you McDonald's would not spend as much on advertising.
No, I got it.
That's what the Yankees are doing.
I understand. I get it. I think a lot of people understand that, but it's frustrating to not see them get a guy that they feel puts them over the top because of that reasoning.
Correct. And again, there were all the individual reasons are quite valid. But as a collective, as you now look at a team that is right there, and they are so close, and how many times did I tell you this year, they're really good, and they played with the Astros. If they get one hit in Game 2 and one hit in Game 3, completely different story. And they're right there. So because they haven't gone over the top, you look back and say, okay, what are the things that we can control that we could do better going forward? And I think that's really all I was trying to get at, not indict anybody for not doing things in the past.
2 years in a row, a everyday player with Tommy John surgery with the news about Hicks, Sween.
Yeah, that's Didi had his surgery about a week before this, early mid-October, and Hicks is going to have Hicks's surgery date is about 2 weeks behind what Didi's was. Didi came back in June and he went flying through. I mean, that was an absolutely perfect rehab. He had zero setbacks. So I think, again, the timetable they laid out for Didi initially was probably sometime after the All-Star break. I think that's what you kind of have to think of in terms of Hicks and feel fortunate if it's anything sooner than that. So much like you went to the offseason last year about Didi, you have to have a plan. Now, last year's plan failed miserably with Troy Tulowitzki. So, fortunately for them,
Mayhew
and Gleyber Torres was right there. But their plan was, we need somebody else to play the position, not just kind of fill the gaps.
I think it's easy. I think it's easy, Sweeney. I think Mike Tauchman's earned
Gardner.
It. No, I don't even think Gardner. I think Tauchman,
really?
He's earned it. Yeah, he earned it.
I think I think Tauchman played well, and I think he's part of it, but I think it's a pretty big leap to say play center field for the New York Yankees for the next team for the next 4 months. And maybe beyond that, you have to be prepared for the fact that it might be 5 months or 6 months.
Well, no, no.
I think that's a big leap.
Look, it's not Mike Tauchman with no safety net. So I'll phrase it this way. I think Aaron Judge could be a factor in center field. I think he can easily go over there and play the position well. You could play Giancarlo in right. But with Tauchman, he played 87 games this year. I get it's not 150. But I look at Tauchman very similarly as the way I looked at Luke Voit and Jeff McNeil. I'll give you a Met and I'll give you a Yankee. Coming out of 18 into 19, they earned it. They played well enough to where they deserve at least that crack at an everyday job. And if they fail, they fail. And I think in both McNeil and Voit's case, they didn't fail. They proved, I know Voit had his injuries, but clearly McNeil earned it. Those guys are now everyday players. And I don't know, to me, 87 games is enough of a sample size with what we saw from Tauchman to say, you know what? These guys at least earned that first opportunity to be the everyday center fielder.
I think that's really good reasoning and a good gamble to take for a team that is, say, contending or looking to contend. When you're a team that is on a championship level, like the Yankees are, and they're that close, I think that's an awfully big risk to take. I think you have to, especially when you saw what you dealt with injuries this year, I think you have to insulate yourself a little bit more than that. This is not throwing shade at Mike Tauchman. He turned out to be a very good acquisition for the team. I think it's a pretty big gamble to make. It's similar to, you know, like Luke Voit ended up being the first baseman for most of the stretch this year. Now, the injury played a big factor in it, but you didn't, it's all part of it. You did not get the full season version of Luke Voit that you got for the 1 month.
But I use the same example. So the main reason Luke Voit didn't play in the postseason was because of Edwin Encarnacion, a guy the Yankees traded for. And that's the way I would look at it in center field. If it fails, if there's a setback with Hicks, all these
you
negative.
You can get somebody?
Yeah, go get somebody. As opposed to giving up assets now. Like, Starling Marte is going to be a guy people bring up because Met fans are going to bring him up, so Yankee fans will too. Center fielder, 1 year left on his deal, why not? Well, the why not is, do you want to use valuable assets to trade for a position in which you can probably do a fairly good job of filling from within? If you have to go make a deal for a center fielder in June or July because a lot of bad things happen, then yeah, go do it like the Yankees did for Edwin Encarnacion.
Yeah, it might not take till June or July though. That's the problem. So
right.
I think you just have to be a little bit more prepared for the fact that, you know, listen, just what if he starts out, listen, if you give him the job and he starts out, you know, 2 for 40, what do you think people are going to be saying? Who do you think they're going to be indicting for not making a better move for a better center fielder and just handing it to a guy who with 87 games? You have to look at the other side of that. And I think you just have to be prepared for a lot more because we've seen how many different things can happen.
Did they re-sign DD or no?
I think so. I think where is, you know, I think how much is really the big question because of the way he finished the year from whatever the date was that he got hit by that pitch in L.A. during that Dodgers series to the end of the season. It was a pretty big, pretty significant drop-off for him there. I don't know if that cost him a lot of money, but it certainly didn't help. I think overall, I think everybody realizes that they're a better team with Didi Gregorius at shortstop and Gleyber Torres at second. I still think that Didi Gregorius is a very attractive free agent. I just wonder where his agent and the Yankees are going to, you know, find that line based off of the last 6 weeks of the season because of the way that turned out. He came back healthy, hit a big home run for them in the playoffs, plays a good defense, but his offensive production, which is what separates you and makes you worth $20 million a year like Xander Bogaerts, that obviously took a little bit of a hit this year coming off the injury and the last, 5 or 6 weeks of the season. So I think there is room for him to be there. The first determination is the qualifying offer. If the Yankees make that qualifying offer, which I would kind of expect them to do, I don't see much downside to that for them. Then you wonder, okay, where's the negotiating go and how high up are the Yankees willing to go? How many years are they willing to extend themselves for him?
Well, when they got CeCe many years ago, I remember Joe and I looked at it and said, they're going to get him. They probably don't even have a number in mind. They are going to outbid anybody to get CeCe Sabathia. Are they going to have that attitude with Gerrit Cole or Steven Strasburg, or are they going to have a number in mind? And if Artie Moreno, so using him as an example, goes through that number, then the Yankees won't sign a big-time starting pitcher.
I think there's absolutely a number in mind. If you go back and think about when they got CeCe Sabathia, and what they were going through. They just missed the playoffs in 08. They were transitioning from Joe Torre to Joe Girardi. First year Joe Girardi was 08. And it's been, pretty well documented, this idea that the Yankees believe their clubhouse culture was broken and they needed to change things. And their star players were getting older and they needed to fix that. The Yankees star players right now are right there. This is not endorsing they do this, but if the Yankees go into next season status quo, it's still a really good team. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
There's still a lot of star players here. So I think the Yankees looked at the idea of where they were then and how broken they thought they were and needed to go the extra mile for that. So I don't believe that that's the same case right now. We'll see how far they're willing to go with these guys and how much they're willing to engage and how far somebody else is willing to go, because other teams have money, other teams have good players, other teams can win. This is not the reality of the 96 to 2000 Yankees, when it just felt like they were there to beat everybody and everybody else was there just to show up.
Sweeney, always a pleasure.
Thank you, Sweeney.
Thanks, fellas.
All right, man.
Sweeney on the Yankees.